Berenger as a priest offering sanctuary to Daphne Zuniga in Last Rites. Chaos erupts when Jessica Lange visits home in Far North. And five young dinosaurs embark on a hazardous journey in the animated adventure, The Land Before Time. It's all coming up next on Siskel and Ebert.
Angela.
I don't know, Padre. I just want to go home to my village.
There's nothing stopping you.
The Padres are looking for me, the police.
Tom Berenger plays a priest protecting a woman who is being hunted by the mob in Last Rites, one of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. Our first movie is named Last Rites, and that's exactly what I'd like to administer to this film, which is easily the most offensive big-budget picture of 1988. The movie stars Tom Berenger as a Catholic priest assigned to St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City. Berenger's father is a mafia don, a godfather, and in the opening scenes of the movie, his sister, also a mafia insider, murders her husband and then comes to her brother in the confessional to ask for absolution.
You didn't grant me absolution.
Because you're not repentant. Your confession was sacrilegious and I won't be bound by it.
I'm swearing to you in the presence of God that I am repentant. How dare you question my sincerity?
Because I know you.
Knowing me doesn't change our obligations. Now, I regret my sins and I don't want absolution. If you won't grant it to me, I'll go to a priest who will.
Berenger discovers that his murdered brother-in-law was having an affair with a Mexican woman played by Daphne Zuniga. At first, she doesn't realize that this priest is related to her dead lover.
Gino? You know Gino?
Don't bull me.
I swear the Madonna, Padre, I don't know what you're talking
and you
about.
You didn't know who I was.
Pace, you said your name was Father Michael Pace.
In English. In Italiano, mi nome si pronuncia Pace.
Taking pity on this endangered woman, Berenger invites her to spend the night with him in his living quarters inside St. Patrick's Cathedral. A fellow priest is a little surprised.
Angelo Martinez, Father Freddy.
Hello, Padre.
All my God.
And you might ask how a priest could live with a woman inside St. Patrick's Cathedral and not be noticed. I don't know. Would you ask that? Did you ask that question?
I was, at that point, not interested in the movie enough to ask that
you
question.
You did not ask that. Well, it occurred to me. But apparently there's only one other priest in the whole cathedral, and that's old Father Freddy there. Anyway, soon after the priest and the woman meet, early in the film, there's a scene that looks as if Berenger and Zuniga are making love. She gets up off the bed. She comes over to him. She takes off his Roman collar. They embrace. There's lots of sex. But actually, they're not really making love. You see, it's only a tempting dream. I think you could probably call it The Last Temptation of Berenger. But I don't want to blame the actors for this disgraceful film. How could they have possibly known that the writer and director, Donald P. Belisario, would pull off the neat trick of making a film that was both tasteless and senseless? The story is so ineptly told that most audiences will never figure out until way late in the film that Berenger even is the son of the mafia leader. That exposition was not handled competently. It's a key thing, and you don't know it. And as for the use of the Catholic Church in this movie, I, for one, am getting a little tired of seeing the vow of chastity and the sacrament of confession being used as cheap gimmicks by filmmakers who are so lacking in imagination that they have to trash somebody's religion to make a movie. Last Rites is shameful.
I thought it was also quite boring, as a movie.
Okay.
I'm tired, I suppose, too, of the whole business of hiding people through the confession. We've seen that as a gimmick in a number of films. The Temptation of Priests, we've seen that. It's getting tired. The characters weren't interesting. Tom Berenger is a very good actor. Mm-hmm. I do hold these people responsible. You don't know what script they were given, Roger, so you can't absolve them.
I've seen Berenger in other good things.
Yeah,
I don't know. I think that they kind of trust the director. You know, and he kind of says, well, we're going to handle this, you know.
I don't want to turn, that's a debate that we'll never
resolve. Okay, well, we don't know, we don't
know. The film is not good.
No.
And it's deadly dull, and you found it offensive.
And I did find it offensive. You know, I haven't seen a priest in a movie in a long time who hasn't had...
Hey, this is like doctors.
Priests are the only people left in the movies who have sex. Nobody else goes to bed with anybody.
That's like hospitals now. Everyone goes to hospital and dies. It used to be you get healthy
in
hospital.
Yeah. Right.
Our next film is the eagerly awaited Oliver and Company, the animated feature film from the Disney studios. And when you measure this picture against the company's legacy of classics, it doesn't match up. Its story is too fragmented, even though it resembles Lady and the Tramp and has characters loosely based on Charles Dickens' Oliver Twist. The film is about an innocent orphan kitten named Oliver, who is eventually befriended by a street-smart dog named Dodger, who sings about how smart he is with Billy Joel's voice.
I'm streetwise, I can improvise.
That's not a memorable tune. More interesting is Dodger's gang of dogs. Dodger makes up a story about how he alone got them all hot dogs when actually Dodger had help from little Oliver, who has followed Dodger home.
He comes at me, eyes burning. I knew my time had come. Suddenly...
Well, what is it?
Hey, man, check it out, huh? Hey, it's an alien!
Cool it, guys. It's just a cat.
That little chihuahua is the cutest character in the movie. The story takes little Oliver and us all over New York, including into a fancy uptown home where we meet a pampered poodle who sings about getting herself together each day. Bette Midler is the musical voice.
Girl, we've got work to do. Pass me the paint and glue. Perfect isn't easy, but it's me. When one knows the world is watching, one does what one must. Some minor adjustments, darling, not for my vanity, but for humanity.
That's another weak song, as this film wanders from its central story, which turns out to be more about how Dodger's gang of dogs has to help their friendly boss named Fagin come up with the money he owes to a big, evil mobster. Little Oliver's story gets sidetracked in a film that I think is too convoluted in its story and too calculated in its attempt to play to different age groups, the Billy Joel and Bette Midler crowd, as well as little kids as well. A more simple story would have been better.
I don't think it's really meant to appeal to the Midler and Billy Joel crowd, because I'm not sure the people, when they go to animated movies, even think about who the voices are.
Well, you know what they do? They put it in the front. It's a personal thing that I don't happen to like. I don't want to know who the voices are.
Uh-huh.
I don't know who the people, who the dwarfs were, who Snow White was, and I don't, you know.
And you don't care.
When they're celebrities, it loses.
Yeah, well, that's something new. They used to have anonymous voiceover artists. Now they have famous people. I'll tell you, I like this movie a little bit better than you did. It's marginal. I guess I give it a thumb up. It's not one of the great classic animated films. And one thing that did bother me, so I don't sound that enthusiastic. Why are these stories always about little childlike figures who are abandoned and orphaned and left alone?
Oh, but that's the story of it. I mean,
doesn't that kind of depress kids? Couldn't there be a happy kid that a movie could be about, you know?
I would think I would be nice. I didn't like seeing the kid have his hand put in a window, or seeing somebody have their...
There was a scene where the electric window goes up in a car and somebody gets strangled. That's not necessarily the sort of thing children should be learning from animated film.
Yeah, it's the one thing when you're talking about swords and dragons, which they're not going to encounter each day, but they are going to play around with electric windows. I didn't care for the film. You did.
I gave it a marginal.
Why are you recommending it?
It was harmless. It was inoffensive. There were some moments that were funny. I liked the little Mexican chihuahua.
The chihuahuas? They should make the film.
The animation looked good. I don't know.
Make the film about the chihuahua.
The thumb is just like this, and that's where it stays. Coming up next, a baby dinosaur goes on a long journey to save his life. Another abandoned animated child in The Land Before Time.
Maybe you cannot talk yet. Huh?
Another animated feature, this one named The Land Before Time. And why is it, as I was saying earlier, that all these animated films for children seem to present such a grim, threatening, deterministic view of the world. Here's a movie about a baby brontosaurus named Littlefoot, whose parents are killed in an earthquake. He's separated from his grandparents. A drought has turned the earth into a desert, and so Littlefoot and four of his chums go on a long trek through the wasteland to a land of green trees far away across the land. So they hope, anyway. Along the way, they encounter lots of terrifying adventures.
You eat us! Run!
The movie is largely about the close calls that Littlefoot has. There are some more tender moments like this one from early in the film.
Have you ever seen the Great Valley?
No.
Well, how do you know it's really there?
Some things you see with your eyes. Others you see with your heart.
Here's one of the reptilian friends that Littlefoot makes along the way.
Long necks don't talk to you, or whatever you are.
Me? I'm a long neck too, see? And I have a long tail like you. All right. I'm not a long neck. I'm a big mouth. But I am all alone. I lost my family in the big earth shake.
You want to go with me?
Yes! Oh, yes, yes, yes. I do.
I basically like The Land Before Time, and I do recommend it, but I have a couple of observations to make. The first one is, why couldn't a movie like this contain a little more natural history and a little more of the sense of wonder of that strange prehistoric time? Why does it mostly have to be violence and close calls and threatening encounters with meat-eating animals? The second observation I have is, why do they choose to make the dinosaurs into English-speaking humans with scales? Why not let them be dinosaurs? Kids today are crazy about dinosaurs, and I'll bet they'd be even more fascinated by reptiles that were truly reptilian than they would be by these dinosaurs that talk as if they were Peter Pan. And
well, how
and
would
so
you
forth.
How would you have them talk? Just
I would not necessarily have them talk. I would do the entire thing in pantomime.
Well,
The wonderful movie I liked so much and you didn't, Benji the Hunted, which didn't have any dialogue in it at all, that little dog saving the leopard cubs and fighting with the wolf and so forth. There was no dialogue in that. It was live animals, so it was harder to do.
Well, I don't know that that would work. I mean, this picture I happen to enjoy. I thought that, and I guess you did too.
Yeah, I did,
okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I thought that it was sweet more than it was scary. Mm-hmm. I thought it was quite beautiful, and I think its story, unlike the one we just talked about before, is a straight line. In other words, it's very clear, it's set up very early on that will the brontosaurus live, or is it going to be eaten up by the Tyrannosaurus Rex? Mm-hmm. And you got a baby you could follow, and it's a straight line story. I think this is the film that I would recommend for children to see.
I would recommend it over Oliver, yes.
Yeah.
And it was directed by Don Bluth, who was a good animator. He made An American Tale.
Yes, it's a beautiful film.
It's a good looking film. There's one logical error in it. Did you catch it? The beginning of the film, the brontosaurus is said to be the last of his species.
Oh, I know.
And at the end, it said that they live for many generations.
But I didn't want to spoil it for everyone. I mean, the answer is, you know, when are they going to get eaten, obviously? It's coming up, and you're going to have to find that out in part two or explain it to your children on the way home why they can't go see a brontosaurus today.
Coming up next, Jessica Lange in Far North returns home from the big city to confront her feisty father down on the farm.
Somebody's got to avenge me. You're the only one left.
North and has an impressive pedigree, written and directed by Sam Shepard and starring Jessica Lange and Charles Durning. Unfortunately, the film is an overwrought mess about a big city woman returning to the family farm after she learns that her gruff father has been injured driving a hay wagon. Now he wants her to kill the horse that pulled the wagon. That's a whole bunch of silly theatrics, but Jessica Lange considers going through with it, much to the dismay of her sister and her mother.
No, is this a 30-06?
I'm not telling you if it's a 30-06. Mel used to be my horse, don't forget. I learned to ride on Mel. Don't point that thing in the house. It could be loaded. Are you crazy?
Katie, don't play with the guns in the house. We don't do that in the house.
All right, take it easy. See that he's always leaving loaded guns around, and you shouldn't take a chance with it.
Well, now, what's the trick to it, anyhow? I mean, we
You know, say somebody wanted to shoot something with it.
You mean like a horse?
How do you aim it?
You see that bead up at the end of the barrel?
Yeah.
You line that up so it's right in the middle of the backside. That's this V thing right there.
More family members are revealed, and this is one strange family, including a grandmother who is slightly off her rocker.
I'm not having a birthday, am I?
This Sunday, Mama. This Sunday's your birthday.
Sunday? I can't have a birthday on the Sabbath. Check the calendar. That's right.
How about two more strange family members? Here's Lang's father, Charles Durning, and her alcoholic uncle, Donald Moffat, in the hospital at the same time. Durning is upset because Lang is pregnant and without a husband.
Who the hell knows what they do on their own these days? You know, they go away to the city, come back pregnant, and they got no man.
Well, don't you worry, Bertram. They'll get a man. Those are good-looking gals you got.
Where are they gonna find one? Not up here, that's for sure. No men left up here.
The parade of sad characters continues with Jessica Lang's nymphette niece and the rivalry between Lang and her sister and whether or not the horse is going to be killed. This film, Far North, is a disaster. I wanted someone to shoot the horse and end the movie.
I was appalled by it. It's a combination of Dog Patch and Eugene O'Neill. I mean, it's like Little Abner gets drunk.
Oh, don't even.
There are scenes in this movie where they're walking in their hospital gowns along the railroad tracks where you want to say, didn't anybody step in and give Shepard some advice here? Is he such a powerful playwright, such a powerful figure, mm-hmm. such an icon that everybody is afraid to tell him that the emperor has no clothes? Yeah. Somebody should have said, Sam, you don't have a screenplay here. You don't know how to direct. You don't have a visual eye. This picture looks bad. It doesn't make any sense. And you're embarrassing these actors.
I would have thought that the actors would have been embarrassed, but... It was actually kind of shocking.
Yeah.
I mean, this is his first directing attempt. Yeah. I suppose anyone could be excused mm-hmm. personally mm-hmm. from doing a bad job directing. Just don't have to see the picture. Coming up next, a child's doll contains the soul of a mass murderer in child's play.
Don't you see?
Critics' lot is a happy one. Today we've had movies about an adulterous priest,
yes.
an orphan kitten, an orphan brontosaurus. A guy that gets out of a hospital bed in order to shoot a horse, and now we have a mass murderer who possesses a child's doll.
Just an average week.
Just another week on the beat. Our next movie is named Child's Play, and it begins with a dying mass murderer, the Lakeshore Strangler, who has studied voodoo and uses black magic to transport his soul into the body of a good guy doll. Catherine Hicks plays the mother who unknowingly buys the possessed doll and brings it home as a present for her son, played by Alex Vincent.
A good guy! I knew it! Get me one.
Show me how he works, okay?
Hi, I'm Andy. What's your name?
Hi, I'm Chucky, and I'm your friend to the end. Heidi ho.
Wow, he's something, isn't he?
After his babysitter is killed by being pushed out the window by the doll, the little boy claims that Chucky the doll is alive, but of course, no one will believe him.
He said Aunt Maggie was a real bitch and got what she deserved.
How can you say something so horrible?
I didn't say it, Chucky did.
Andy, stop it. You know perfectly well that you're making this up.
But I'm not. Chucky's alive.
Not even Hicks believes her own son until she makes the chilling discovery that Chucky can talk, even though he doesn't have any batteries.
Wanna play?
Child's Play is a good example of the sort of horror movie that I call the false alarm film, because every time there's a false alarm and then everybody relaxes, then the creature attacks.
Big surprise.
The movie is well made with convincing performances by Catherine Hicks and little Alex Vincent. And I guess I should also mention they did a good job on the doll. In the early scenes, it looks so wholesome, you know it has something wrong with it. And in the later scenes, it transforms itself into a truly frightening personality. It was an effective horror film.
It wasn't an effective, no. It was not for me, no. I mean, I laughed at the doll, and I also don't like to have scenes with children in terrorized situations. You remember, you said at the top of the show about how you were sick and tired of seeing priests being used as villains in a way, or their sacraments being tossed around. I hate to see kids in perilous situations. I think it's one of the easiest, cheapest thrills that you can do.
This is a plucky little kid, and he stands up for himself, and he is not just simply running around screaming.
He's not entirely.
He's given something to do, and he's a pretty good actor.
I think that the business, if you want a picture about where a doll comes alive and is really threatening, I think a good film was, a better film was with Anthony Hopkins and Anna Margaret called Magic a few years ago. This film is not that league. I just thought it was silly, and I didn't buy it at all. Now let's recap the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for Last Rites, the priest murder mystery that I disliked and Roger despised. A split decision on Oliver and Company, although Roger has yet to fully explain why he liked the animated movie. I thought the story was confused. Two thumbs up for The Land Before Time, the dinosaur picture that I found charming, and we both agreed is beautifully drawn. Two thumbs down, way down, for Far North, the depressing and disorganized, and you can pick any other negative adjective you want, Sam Shepard's family drama. A split vote on the horror film Child's Play. I thought it was silly. Roger thought it worked. So the one that I liked the best was The Land Before Time.
Land Before Time for me and Child's Play, yeah, but it's not one of the great weeks in the history of the American motion picture.
Okay.
Maybe better luck next week when we're going to be back to review Scrooge, the Christmas comedy starring Bill Murray. And we'll also review Cocoon, The Return, with Don Ameche, Steve Guttenberg, and a lot of the other veterans from the original Cocoon. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Nestle Crunch. It's creamy milk chocolate and crispy crunchies. Chocolate is scrunches when it crunches. That's why you'll love Nestle Crunch. What's great for kids and parents? A bucket full of Duplo blocks and Lego bricks. Now you can store the toys that build great imaginations. After work or after workout, Daisy Turbo Spa combines powerful water massage and tingling aeration to turn your tub into a personal whirlpool. Sony videotapes. For taping your favorite movies, trust Sony Dynamicron ES. Whatever your videotape needs, there's only one name to play back. Sony.